हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज समीरन मैथी, सीनियर लेक्चरर इन कंप्यूटर इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट फ्रॉम प्रवीण पाटिल पॉलिटेक्निक। आई होप यू गाइस नो दैट वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद द लास्ट चैप्टर, दैट इज फिफ्थ चैप्टर ऑफ ACN, एंड वी हैव ऑलरेडी कंप्लीटेड द पार्ट वन ऑफ चैप्टर फाइव। सो इफ यू रिमेंबर, वी हैव एंडेड पार्ट वन विद दिस स्लाइड। सो कमिंग टू द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड, वी हैव HTTP मैसेजेस। सो HTTP मैसेजेस आर ऑफ टू टाइप्स, ऑब्वियसली रिक्वेस्ट एंड रिस्पॉन्स। Request will be sent from client to server and response will be sent from server to client. Now both messages types used same format, and this is the request message. A format in consists of a request line, header information, black line, and in case of body, which is again optional, right? So in case they are asking HTTP messages, you are supposed to draw this diagram, fine. And coming to the theoretical aspect of HTTP, firstly we have request line. It is used for defining the request type, resource URL, and HTTP version. The example for the same is given in the last row. If you could see, GET is an HTTP request type, and we have home.html as URL, and the HTTP version we have 1.1. regarding request type, like we have GET, we have POST, and we have various types of request types. So in the given example, we have GET as request type. The URL defines four things: method, host computer, port, and path. Fine. So method, host computer, port, and path. Fine. So method is the protocol used to retrieve the document, is the command of request issued by client to server. Some of the messages referred as methods are, we could use GET, we could use PUT, we could use COPY, we could use DELETE, and so on, fine. Then we have the response message. Again, it consists of the same, it consists of the same diagram as of request message, request line, header information, blank line, and again optional body part. Now status line, it is used for defining the status of the response message. I hope you guys know what is the status of response message, in the sense it is about to receive or it is about to reach, and so on. What is the status of the packet, right? So status line gives us, it is used for defining the status of the response message. Coming to HTTP version, this field indicates the version of HTTP being used. For example, it could be 1.1, it could be 1.0, and so on. Regarding status code, this field indicates three date field, which is similar to those in FTP and SMTP protocol. So whatever the status is for any response message, such things are being managed by or translated into code for machine to machine communication. So what is the status of a response message for machine to machine communication? We have status code. Coming to status phrase, it is used for explaining status code in text form. So it is, status phrase is for users, status code is for machines. I hope the point is clear, fine. Coming to headers, it can be one or more header lines, right? Each header line is made of header name, a colon, space, and a header value, as we can see in the last row. Each header line is made of header name, colon, space, and a header value. The header exchange additional information is shared between, obviously, client and server. The header belongs to one of the four categories. It could be a general header, it could be a request header if it is from client side, it could be a response header if it is from server side, and it could be both, that is entity header. Fine. There are two types of connections as far as HTTP is concerned. We have persistent and we have non-persistent connections of HTTP. Now it is also known as RTT, that is round trip time. I hope everyone knows what is round trip time. It is nothing but the validity of a particular packet. We have seen in ping like commands, fine. So time for a small packet to travel from client to server and back. From client to server, for example, 2 microseconds, and from server to client, for example, 3 microseconds. So the RTT for the given packet or the the example we have considered is 5 microseconds, right? For a connection, persistent or non-persistent, it is sure that to initiate TCP connection, 1 RTT is used. So whether it could be persistent or non-persistent, irrespective of a connections of HTTP, it has to be at least 1 RTT to initiate TCP connection. This is a general rule. 1 RTT is used for HTTP request and first few bytes to HTTP response to return. So for HTTP again, 1 RTT is used and some more few bits to HTTP response to return, right? Now non-persistent connections are of two types, without parallel connection and with parallel connection. In without parallel connection, we have each object takes 2 RTT, one for TCP and other for HTTP. So without parallel connection, each object takes 2 RTT and one for TCP and the other for HTTP. Now parallel connection is shown with the help of this diagram. So client will initiate a TCP connection, fine. So it will go to server and that particular packet will again come back to client. That will be considered as 1 RTT, fine. And again request file will be sent from client to server and again from server to client. Now if you could see, there is a block in server side at the last row, that is the time to transmit file from server to client. So you can see there is a bit of delay, the block shows a bit of delay from server side. So that is nothing but time to transmit file, it is taken by the server. And finally with other RTT we get the entire file received. I hope the point is clear. So again in parallel connection, it is taking 2 RTT, first RTT for requesting file and the second RTT for receiving the entire file. I hope the point of parallel connection is clear as well as the diagram is clear. Regarding a persistent connection, we have non-pipelined and pipelined. Non-pipeline connection, first established connection which takes 2 RTT, then we send all objects, it could be images, it could be text files, which takes 1 RTT each. So first established connection which takes 2 RTT, then we send all objects, images or text file, which takes 1 RTT each. That was non-pipeline. And for pipeline connection, we have 2 RTT for connection establishment and 1 RTT for all objects. So pipeline connection has 2 RTT for connection establishment, right, and 1 RTT for all objects. But in non-pipeline, it takes 1 RTT each. For example, if there is image, so 1 RTT for image. If there is one text, 1 RTT for text. If there is maybe video, so 1 RTT for video. That was regarding non-pipeline. But in pipeline, irrespective of number of images or text files or videos, it takes only 1 RTT for all the objects combined. I hope the point is clear. Now difference between persistent and non-persistent, here the version used is 1.1 and here it is used is 1.0. it uses 1 RTT. You can also write RIT, but I would prefer you write RTT. And non-persistent, it uses 2 RTT. And regarding persistent, TCP connection is not closed, fine. But regarding non-persistent, TCP connection is closed after every request is closed, fine. So in persistent, it is not closed at all, but here it is closed after every request response. It is default mode and this is not default mode. Excuse me. Proxy server, HTTP supports the proxy server. A proxy server is a computer that keeps copies of responses to recent requests. Copies of responses are saved to recent request. The HTTP client sends a request to the proxy server. The proxy server checks its cache first. If the response is not stored in the cache, द प्रॉक्सी सर्वर सेंड्स द रिक्वेस्ट टू द करस्पॉन्डिंग सर्वर. फर्स्ट इट विल चेक इट्स कैश. इफ इट डज नॉट हैव द इंफॉर्मेशन देन ओनली इट विल सेंड द रिक्वेस्ट टू द करस्पॉन्डिंग सर्वर. फाइन. इन केस इफ द प्रॉक्सी सर्वर हैज द इंफॉर्मेशन रिक्वेस्टेड बाय क्लाइंट देन इट वोंट return the request to the corresponding server. Instead, it will pass on the data to the client. I hope the point is clear. Incoming responses are sent to proxy server and stored for future requests from the client. So, proxy server works as an assistant to server. The proxy server reduces the load on the original server because it works as an assistant to the server, and hence it decreases traffic and improves latency, that is speed. Fine. Regarding file transfer protocol, FTP is the standard mechanism provided by TCP/IP for copying a file from one host to another. We have already configured the same using Cisco packet tracer. So this theoretical aspect will be a cakewalk for you guys, right? FTP establishes two connections. Firstly, it will transfer the data with the help of port 20, and which opens and close for each file transfer. And we also have control information that remains connected through entire FTP session, and the port dedicated for the same is 21. So in case if you could see this diagram, we have a user has his own interface. Then we have data control, data transfer as well as control in client. In server also we have data transfer and control. So data connection will be managed by data transfer, and control connection will be managed by control process, since this works for both TCP/IP. So it is being shown as TCP/IP, and each data could have actual data or passive data with them. So for that they are also connected to disk. I hope FTP's diagram is clear. FTP is designed for distributing files to a number of users. FTP is interactive. FTP programs accepts a sequence of commands, which we have seen in the configuration aspect. It runs on top of TCP like HTTP. So communication in FTP, communication over control connection. FTP uses a set of ASCII characters to communicate across control connections. So for client control and for server control, FTP does communicate with the help of ASCII characters, as we can see in the given diagram. Control over data connection. So here controlling of data connection takes place. So it is again used to transfer file. As you could see, we have data transfer which is again connected to its local data, we have data transfer of server which is again connected to its local data, and both client and server does data connection with the help of data transfer process. Fine. I hope the point is clear. And FTP can transfer one of the following file types: ASCII file, EBCDIC file, image file. And data structures, such data structures are used: file structure, record structure and page structure. Such things are to be taken care of while implementing FTP. And regarding transmission mode of the same, we have stream mode. In this mode, the data is delivered from FTP to TCP in the form of continuous stream of bits. Continuously data will be sent. Fine. In block mode, the data delivery from FTP to TCP takes place in the form of blocks of data. Fine. And in compressed mode, in case the data is big, for big files the data can be compressed. Now file transfer takes place over the data connection, and the commands are sent over the control connection. These things we have already actually configured in the Cisco packet tracer. Firstly, retrieving file, copying a file from server to client, storing file from client to server, and finally retrieving file, list of files or directory from server to client. In case if you remember FTP configuration, we have done all these steps. Fine. So we have also used FTP commands like get for server to client, and for put client to server. Connect to remote host, we could use such commands like open user pass site. There are two types of termination session: quit, which terminates the whole FTP, and close, which only disconnects but does not terminate. Fine. So this was it regarding chapter 5 part 2. I'll soon upload chapter 5 part 3. Thank you for watching the video. Take care. Bye.